Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining us for this online worship service. We're so excited to continue our series on prayer called Teach Us to Pray. And I've just enjoyed this series so much. And I want to challenge you right off the bat. The whole point of this series is not just to learn more about prayer, but it's to become closer with Jesus, to walk more deeply with Him in relationship with Him through prayer. And so I want to encourage you not just to hear these talks, but to actually engage with them and to actually practice some of the things we're talking about at home in your own walk with the Lord so that you can grow in your prayer life. Now, the first week we started this series, we talked about praying personally because this is a personal relationship with God who loves us so much. And last week we talked about praying simply. We went through the Lord's Prayer and just some very simple phrases of prayers that we can pray and how to sort of frame the way we pray and approach prayer. And then today we want to talk about praying corporately. And corporately is a little different. It's when we pray together. It's when we pray in groups. It's when we pray with other people and we come together. There's something powerful and amazing that happens. And I want us to look at a passage of scripture from Acts. And this is really a look at the early church. And there's some powerful things that happened when they came together and prayed and really believed God, that God was at work in their midst, that God was doing things. And they came together by faith, trusting Him in prayer. And so I want us to look at this passage. It's in Acts chapter 4. So if you've got a Bible and you want to follow along or open your Mission Church app and follow along with the notes there. But one of the things I want to do is set it up a little bit with the context. You see, in Acts chapter 3, Peter and John, two of the disciples and apostles of Jesus, they heal this man who was a lame beggar. And they literally just tell him to stand up and walk. And so everyone is amazed, and there's this huge crowd that gathers, and Peter and John just capture that moment. I mean, they're just bold with the gospel, and they start telling everyone, like, we didn't do this. This miracle happened because of who Jesus is. And they start sharing about Jesus, preaching and proclaiming who Jesus is and that He's risen from the dead. Well, the religious leaders, the ones who killed Jesus, get really upset about this. They are upset. They're mad. They don't want people talking about Jesus. And so they actually arrest Peter and John. And they throw them into prison. And they're persecuting them and holding them hostage, right? Because they've been preaching this message. And the religious leaders tell them, you're not allowed to tell people about Jesus. You're not allowed to share your faith. You're not allowed to do these things. And so there's this persecution that's starting to come against the early church. Now, Peter and John are like, hey, you can tell us that, but we're going to obey God instead of man. We have to follow what God has told us to do, and we're just going to do our thing. So they end up getting released and going back home to where the other Christians are gathered. And that's where we kind of pick up the story in Acts chapter 4. I want you to hear about the discussion they have and the prayer meeting that they have in Acts 4. So this is Acts 4, 23. It says, when they were released, they went to their friends and reported what the chief priests and the elders had said to them. And when they all heard it, they lifted their voices together to God. And they said, Sovereign Lord, who made the heaven and the earth and the sea and everything in them, who through the mouth of our father David, your servant, said by the Holy Spirit, why did the Gentiles rage and the peoples plot in vain? The kings of the earth set themselves and the rulers were gathered together against the Lord and against His anointed. For truly in this city there were gathered together against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate, along with the Gentiles and the peoples of Israel, to do whatever your hand and your plan had predestined to take place. And now, Lord, look upon their threats and grant to your servants to continue to speak your word with all boldness, while you stretch out your hand to heal, and signs and wonders are performed through the name of your holy servant Jesus. And when they had prayed, the place in which they were gathered together was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and continued to speak the word of God with boldness. All right, that's kind of a long passage, and so I want to take a few moments and just break it down. One of the pattern that you kind of see here in Acts chapter 4 is that you have the preaching of the gospel, and then that's followed by persecution of the church, and then that's followed by prayer. So you have this little pattern where they're walking through this. And what I want you to notice is that in the face of opposition, the early church, there's so many ways they could have responded to this, right? But I want you to think about it. They didn't panic. They didn't worry, and they didn't get afraid. That would have been an easy reaction, right? Like, Jesus gave us this mission, and now the religious leaders are against us too. What if they're going to try to kill us? What if they're going to try to harm our families? What if we get thrown into prison again? There could have been so many fears, so many anxious thoughts that could have come into their thinking about what's going to happen to the church, what's going to happen to the plan of God. Notice in this passage, there's no worry. There's no fear. There's none of that. I also want you to notice, I mean, they could have taken action, right? I mean, we live in a culture where we want to fight back. We want to take action. We want to take it to the man. Somebody persecutes us, we want to dish it back to them. And I noticed that, you know, they didn't organize a rally to try to affect the public opinion in the square. They didn't stage a sit-in at the temple. They didn't write letters or blog posts or social media posts and try to change people's thinking about this. You know, they didn't take some poll to try to prove that the majority of the people thought they should have the freedom to, you know, share about Jesus or something like that. They didn't do any of those things. What they did was they went to prayer. They went straight to prayer. They just said, there's persecution. This is what's happening. And we're going to go to prayer. And I want to break down their prayer a little bit, because probably reading it, you're like, this is not a prayer that I would normally pray. And I want us to look at that prayer a little bit. And I want us to see a few things that come out of the prayer. The first thing I want you to see is that they recognize God's sovereignty. They recognize God's sovereignty. I want you to write that down. Sovereignty is kind of a big word. It's not a word we use all the time, but sovereignty of God just means that God is in complete control of everything, that God sees and knows everything, and that everything is under His control. And their prayer really starts with this acknowledgement, this recognition that, God, you're in control. Like, you've got all this figured out. You know all the answers, and we're just going to trust you. And the way they do that is they start off by quoting this prayer from the Old Testament. And so this is actually from Psalm chapter 2. And the first few verses of Psalm chapter 2 say this: "Why do the nations rage and the peoples plot in vain? The kings of the earth set themselves and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against His anointed, saying, let us burst their bonds apart and cast away their cords from us." Now, this is an interesting reference, right? They're going back to their Old Testament Bible. They're like, we know some things are true about God, and we know some things are true about people, and we're going to pray these things back to God. There's a whole other message here about using Scripture when you pray, and we'll have to do that another time. But one of the powerful things here is this passage in Acts chapter 2 is really referring to the nations and the peoples of the earth who just rebel against God. They shake their fist at God and say, God, we don't need you. God, we're going to fight against you. We're going to rebel against who you are. And it says, why do they do that? It says that they want to burst their bonds apart and cast away their cords from us. That's kind of a figurative language for saying they don't want to submit to God's rule in their life. They don't want to come under the authority of God. They don't want to follow His commandments and be obedient to Him. They want to live life their own way. Right? We can all relate to that. We all do that in our own way. And we live in a culture and society that wants to constantly rebel against who God is. And yet the disciples and the church, they begin their prayer by acknowledging, God, the peoples of the earth want to rebel and push back against you, but it's pointless. It's to no avail. There's no reason why they should do that, because you're sovereign. You made the heavens and the earth. You're controlling everything. And no matter what the people do, your purposes still prevail. That's the whole point of their prayer, that your purposes still prevail. And then they even give some examples of what's happening right there in their current moment, right? The church is praying, and they're praying this. Look back again in verse 27. It says, "For truly in this city," they're talking about Jerusalem right at that moment, were gathered together against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed both Herod and Pontius Pilate. They're referring to the fact that just weeks before, the religious rulers of that day had crucified and killed the anointed one, Jesus, the Messiah, and that God had sovereignly worked, that even though they meant it for evil, God used it for good. That even though they were trying to thwart the plan of God, that they had no idea that God was at work despite all of the things that were happening in the midst of that. Now, I don't know about you, but one of the things that I couldn't help but notice and just be burdened for this week on the media was all of this turmoil that's happening in Afghanistan. Seeing the images of the planes taking off and people literally clinging to an airplane, trying to fly away from a country where there's so much war and turmoil and hate and slaughter. It was just heart-wrenching to see that. And I felt this week like the Lord speaking to me through this passage as I'm studying it, as I'm preparing to share it with you, that this is just a reminder to us that even when there's evil people in charge, like Herod and Pontius Pilate trying to take out the Messiah, even when there's evil people in charge, like the Taliban trying to take out people in Afghanistan, God is still sovereign. He's still in control. He is still seated on the throne. His purposes cannot be thwarted. And this is a great reminder to us. And I just love how they started this prayer with the right perspective. They just framed everything else they were going to frame by starting their prayer off to say, God, we know you're in control. We know that no matter what the nations do, no matter what the political leaders do, no matter what's happening, we know you're in control. We know you're sovereign. And we can trust in that. We can rest in that. And so they did. And then notice now that the second thing I want you to notice about their prayer is that they prayed for boldness. This church asked for boldness. I mean, it's amazing to me that they just faced persecution. They were probably spit at. They were probably beaten on. There were probably some choice words that were said to them. These are powerful people, the same people who had Jesus killed. And they're facing this. They're getting thrown into prison. You can imagine the thoughts they would have had, the fear they would have had, the feelings of being separated from their friends, their family members, and wondering if this was going to lead to their own deaths. And yet, when they got together to pray, their first thought wasn't to pray for safety. Can you imagine that? I mean, that just blows my mind. They didn't even think about praying for safety. God, keep us safe, right? That wasn't the prayer. That's what I would have prayed, right? That's what you would have prayed. We would have prayed, Lord, we're getting this persecution. Would you keep us safe? But they didn't do that. They didn't pray that God would put a stop to the persecution. They didn't say, Lord, people are hurting us. Would you make it stop? They didn't pray that. They didn't pray that God would rain down fire and brimstone and judge the people who were hurting and persecuting them and that God would put an end to it. They didn't pray any of that. Instead, they prayed, God, would you give us boldness because we want to follow you. We want to keep obeying your command to share Jesus. God, we know there's going to be a cost. We know that these religious leaders are upset, but we're going to continue to follow you. We're going to continue to do that. So would you give us boldness to continue to share our faith, even in the midst of this persecution? No matter what happens, God, just give us boldness. And I wonder about you. I know I was convicted in reading this, that my prayers so often are, Lord, help me, bless me, keep me from pain and discomfort, and help me to have an amazing life that's full of joy and happiness and peace and prosperity and all those kind of wonderful things. And it just challenged me. It kind of reminded me last week, we talked about the Lord's Prayer and how the Lord's Prayer begins with an acknowledgement of who God is and a focus on his character and nature. And then we start to ask for the things that we want. And I love how the early church, they're kind of following that same pattern, right? They started with saying, God, you're sovereign. You're in control of everything. And your purposes are first. We want your purposes to stand. And in light of that, now we're going to ask for what we want. And notice how their wants changed. Instead of praying for peace and prosperity and end of persecution, safety, all those things, they chose to pray for boldness to stand firm in their faith in the midst of persecution. Man, that challenges me. It challenges the things that I pray about. It challenges me to pray more about big picture things, more kingdom things, to focus my mind and my heart on things that are not selfish and about my own safety and security. During our last series, we talked about rise and build. And we talked about boldly stepping out of our comfort zones and how so often we miss out on what God wants for us because we're too worried about safety. And this was just a reminder to me where the disciples in the early church were like, we're going to go forward with the gospel. We're going to go forward with the church. And look how God blessed that and used that and all the miracles that God did. And you wonder if they had had instead a heart to be safe, a heart to be secure, a heart to have a nice little, you know, middle class living where there was no problems and no pain and no turmoil. You wonder what would have happened to the church and to the gospel if they had asked for safety and comfort instead of boldness. But they didn't do that. They prayed, God, give us boldness. Listen to this prayer. It says, now, Lord, look upon their threats and grant to your servants to continue to speak your word with all boldness. I love that. It's like, Lord, we see the threats. We know they're there, but you've called us to be bold. You've called us to share the gospel, and we're going to be bold. Help us to be bold. Help us to be obedient. Help us to follow Jesus. I love that prayer. So they asked for boldness, but also they trusted that God would move. They trusted God to move in the midst of this. I love this last phrase of the prayer. It says in verse 30, that while you stretch out your hand to heal and signs and wonders are performed through the name of your holy servant, Jesus. They don't even ask God to do great things. They just say, God, we know you're going to be over here healing and doing signs and wonders, and Jesus is still alive and doing amazing things. So you give us boldness while you do your stuff. All right, you keep doing your big stuff, God. We want your movement to continue. We want everything you're building in this church to continue. You just give us boldness, and we're trusting that you're still at work. We're trusting that. And so they had the right perspective about the sovereignty of God. They had the right perspective about praying for the right needs at the moment and praying for boldness. And then now they're trusting, God, we know you're still on the move. We know you're still moving despite what our circumstances suggest. And I wonder wherever you're watching right now, maybe you've got some circumstances in your life that feel out of control. Maybe you're battling a health situation. Maybe there's a financial crisis or something going on in your marriage or relationship. And you just feel like, man, I don't know how I can handle this. And I want to encourage you. You can trust God. You can know that he's sovereign, that he's in control of the situation. You can know that you can believe that he's at work no matter what your circumstances suggest, that God is continuing to work in that way. One of my favorite prayers to pray for our church and for our ministry is that God would show up and do what only God can do, right? So often I think we live in our own power, our own strength. And one of my prayers is so often, God, would you show up and do the things that only you can do? And I love how the early church trusted God to do the same thing. They prayed and they said, God, you give us boldness, but we're trusting that you're still on the move. We know you're not going to stop. And we trust you're going to keep moving mountains and healing and performing signs and wonders. And so I love that. And then look at the response to this prayer that the early church prayed. Look at verse 31. It says, and when they had prayed, the place in which they were gathered together was shaken. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and continued to speak the word of God with boldness. Can you imagine being at a prayer meeting and suddenly the whole building starts to shake? I mean, that's powerful. The Holy Spirit of God fell on that place and acknowledged, I hear you. I see you. I understand what you're going through, and I'm going to answer your prayer. I'm at work in the midst of your difficult and challenging situation. God's Spirit, it says, moved on each person, like the Holy Spirit just filling them and continuing to give them the boldness they needed to proclaim the gospel. God was at work in every person in that group. The power of praying together. I believe there's something powerful that happens when we come together in prayer. So often we think of prayer as being on our own in a quiet place with God on our own time. And that's good. And we've talked about that. And that's so needed. But there is a powerful dynamic that happens when we get with other people and pray. One of the discouraging things for me as a pastor is that so often the Christians that I connect with are really embarrassed or afraid to pray in front of other people. They they get awkward and uncomfortable. And maybe you've been in a situation like that before where you're praying and hoping, like, don't call on me. I don't want to pray or talk in front of anyone. I don't want to pray in front of other people. But what would happen if we got out of our comfort zones? What would happen if we laid down our pride? What would happen if we set our fears aside? What would happen if we got together and we prayed and we just said, God, we want to see a move of God. And we believe that when your people come together and pray, that you are in it and that you work and move in a powerful way. What if we believe God's word, that he comes and fills up that moment when we pray together? And so I want to encourage you. Corporate prayer doesn't just have to be with the church on a Sunday at a worship service. Corporate prayer can be with your spouse, praying together over your family, over your kids, over your future. Corporate prayer can be praying together with friends. Corporate prayer can be praying in a small group. We've been talking about how life change happens in small group, and we want you to be part of a small group. And that dynamic of praying together just brings your hearts together. And you can pray with your family. Fathers, I encourage you. Dads, take the lead in this and step out and lead in your home in prayer. Make sure that your family is praying when you gather together for a meal. Make sure you're praying over significant decisions together. Make sure that you're covering your family and creating an atmosphere of prayer in your home. It's such a powerful opportunity that you have as a leader and a spiritual leader in your home. So I want to challenge us, are we praying together? Are we praying corporately? Because I believe that when the church comes together and prays, God moves in a powerful way. And I believe that if we as a church, Mission Church, gather together and we pray in small groups and families and homes and restaurants, and we bathe our ministry and our families and our marriages and our relationships and our finances, all of these things in prayer, that God will show up and God will do things that we can't even imagine. Now, in our worship services this week, we're going to take some time to pray corporately together over some things. But I want to encourage you, you can do the same thing watching online at home. I want to encourage you to get with a family member or a friend or someone that you're with. And I want to encourage you to pray. We're going to pray over the situation in Afghanistan, that God would have mercy on the people there, that God's justice would prevail. We're going to pray for our country. We're going to pray for our political leaders who need wisdom. God tells us to pray for our leaders, even the ones we didn't vote for. We're going to pray for them. We're going to trust that God's working in them, giving them wisdom. And we're going to pray over the division in our nation right now. There's so much division and hatred, and we need God's grace to come and bring unity in our country. And so we're going to pray for Afghanistan. We're going to pray for our country, and we're also going to pray for our city. We want to pray for the city of Goodyear. We believe that right now our church is in a strategic time where we're moving toward opening a brand new building and having so many opportunities to share the gospel. And we're praying that God's preparing hearts and that the Spirit of God will move, and that you and I and each one of us in the church are going to be bold, just like these disciples were, to share their faith and invite people into church and to see the kingdom of God coming in the city of Goodyear where we live. And that's what we're praying for. So I want to encourage you, get with someone that you live with or someone, family member or friend, and take some time to pray corporately this week and trust that God's going to move and do something great. Let's pray. God, thank you for your word. Thank you for this powerful story from the early church, the reminder that, Lord, when your people gather corporately and pray, you show up and you do great things. And God, we just trust that you will lay it on our hearts, that you'll challenge us. Lord, I ask that you would challenge our church to be a people of prayer, not just in our private prayer closets. That's so important. That's where it starts. But that would overflow in our families, in our friendships, in our small groups, and in our church body. And that, Lord, you would raise up a church that is a powerful prayer presence in our community. And Lord, we pray over the things happening in our world right now. We pray for mercy in Afghanistan for these people, Lord. We pray for your justice in that nation right now. We pray for your protection, especially for women and for children, Lord, for those that are fleeing the Taliban. Lord, we pray that you would provide. God, we pray for our nation. Our nation is so divided right now, and we ask for unity in our country. We pray for our political leaders. And Lord, we ask you to give them wisdom and guidance in such a difficult time. And Lord, we pray over our community. We pray, God, that you would flood our community with your presence. And that, Lord, as we sit in this strategic moment as a church with an opportunity to use this tool, our new building, to reach out to our community, Lord, I pray that you would help us to be bold and strategic, that you would give us boldness for the gospel. And Lord, that we would unashamedly proclaim that Jesus is alive and risen from the dead, and that we would see revival come in our own city, Lord, and change as people give their lives to Christ and follow after you. So Lord, we trust that you're going to be at work. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. We want to thank you again for watching. We hope you'll enjoy the rest of the service as we worship together and as we close with some important announcements and reminders. We want to invite you to connect with us. If God's been moving in your heart through this message series, please reach out to us. We'd love to know how we can pray for you, how we can encourage you to take your next step in your relationship with Jesus. Thank you again for watching. God bless you. And remember, you are loved.
Search the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and treasures that fade are never enough. Then you came along and put me back together. Desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. God of the valley, and there's
hello again, Mission Church. Once again, my name is Pastor Tyler, and thank you for joining us today. We hope that this series in prayer has been an encouragement to you and your family, and we hope that you really take stuff away from this series, just as we have as well. And so we would love for you to connect more deeply with us today. You can click on the connect link on whichever platform you are watching on right now. And we would love to just, whether you've been watching with us for a while or this is your first time or you are streaming this on demand right now on YouTube or Facebook, we would love to just for you to let us know that you're here today, that you're watching with us. Please let us know if there's any ways we can be praying for you. Again, we would love to connect with you. Next, we have small groups starting. And this is a huge announcement because small groups has always been one of the most important and one of the most vital ways to get connected here into the life at Mission Church. And so starting this next month in September, we are going to have groups going for about 10 weeks. And we have an online option if that suits you. If you are an online viewer, we have that. But we also have a few different in-person small group options as well. And they are pretty spread out throughout the week. And so we have tons of different options. So please visit our website or you can visit our app as well. Mission Church AZ, you can plug that into your app store and you can check out all the different small groups that we have. You can look at the leaders and pick which night is best for you and your family if you have a family that'll be joining you as well. So please check that out. We would love for you to get connected into small groups today. So next up, I would love to introduce you to one of our elders here at Mission Church, Eric Peterson. And basically one of his jobs along with the other elders is to help Pastor Kyle along with making huge decisions here at Mission Church. They are leaders there. They are here for accountability and he would actually love to share a huge announcement that we will be doing as a church, a part of our Rise and Build campaign.
Hello, Mission Church. My name is Eric Peterson. I'm one of the elders here at Mission, and I'm so excited to come to you and show you just a little bit of what's going on in what is our new home. It's not there yet. We're getting close, and we are praying and seeking the Lord to be able to open the doors for this facility in October. And in order to be able to do that, there are a number of things left to finish this off and finish it right and make this a house of worship that we would be excited to invite people to. What's left is about $40,000. $60,000 has already come in the Rise and Build campaign, and that's amazing, and we're so grateful for the sacrificial giving that's already happened. You can see some cards around, and those cards are commitment cards for you and your family to take and consider and pray over what part can you contribute before this 6 weeks expires and we get to our launch date in October. Maybe that isn't a $200 pledge. That's broken down over 200 people, which is close to our regular attendance for Mission. That would bring us to what we need. Sacrificial giving for some might be $20, and sacrificial giving for others might be much, much more than that. And so what we would ask you to do is to take that card, to pray with your families, with your spouse, with your children, to determine what you can cheerfully and sacrificially give towards this new home. And we've often said, we're not asking what you can give. We're seeking what you can get. And what can you get if you're part of this campaign in this 6 weeks? What you get is to celebrate with everyone who's baptized, recognizing that they've become a new creation in Christ. For everyone who trusts Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, you get to celebrate with them and give glory to our Father in heaven for what He has provided. Those are amazing events, and we want you to be part of that here. We've got a number of things that we still need to account for. Additional lighting and seats and all of the finishing touches that will make this new home an incredible place to be. And so what you get. You get a new church home, and you get a new church home, and you get a new church home. That's what you get. And you get to celebrate with us, provided you've been part of launching the new home for Mission. But the time is short. So please, take that card. In the next week or two, we would ask you to fill out your commitment and get that back to us so we know how to plan and can already begin to celebrate and glorify God for what He's doing here in the city of Goodyear where He's planted us. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Eric, for that challenge. We hope and pray that you will be praying about how you can be involved in this Rise and Build campaign, in this last final push these next few weeks. Well, church, thank you for joining us today. We are excited to have you hopefully tune in with us again. We hope that you have a very blessed week.